The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
This is what we can look forward to on episode 314 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
I just want to celebrate everything and anything positive.
I'm going to get a little emotional on you here. My hashtag for 2021, I hope, is hashtag crying because I stepped foot into Disneyland.
I mean, I guess the good news was that we didn't have any movies come out this year, so that actually worked in our favor.
This book hit me subconsciously because I had like this epic dream right after I finished.
Comic-Con at home, hold Force Fest spear.
Oh, man. Jedi can do their hair with the Force! I'm excited!
So are they as vicious or as threatening as other Star Wars villains we've seen, or are they in denial?
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland!
Here we go!
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, Skywalkers, and Happy New Year! We hope everyone had a great holiday season. We recharged our batteries and even planned out lots of great surprises coming in 2021. But for right now, we want to welcome everyone back to Skywalking Through Neverland. I am Richard Woloski, but now everyone please say hello to my New Year sweetie wife, Sarah.
That's me.
I was going to call you a New Year baby, but that didn't make any sense.
No, please don't call me baby.
It worked better in my head. But you know what? I edited in my head, which is why I didn't say it.
That's very good. Well, we are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. And now it's time to sprinkle some pixie dust and give a big Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers. And if you're here listening for the first time, then you are now a Skywalker. So join us and the rest of the Skywalker family on a fun and positive adventure through fandom.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on January the 3rd. Wait for it, 2021. We made it. We're finally here. And our first show of the new year and into our eighth year.
Wow. What?
8 years. I'm jumping the gun by 8 months.
Yeah, that's true. Well, that's okay still.
But I just want to celebrate everything and anything positive.
That's true, including that we are sponsored by Small World Vacations. They are a diamond level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world. And best of all, their service is free of charge. So head to smallworldvacations.com for a no obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
All right, Skywalkers, coming up on this supersized episode, we have our traditional look back at the year we just left. So we'll be skywalking through 2020, and that'll be the last time we talk about 2020. We're going to discuss our fandom highlights, our personal highlights, the things that didn't meet our expectations. One thing really comes to mind, we'll go into later on. Personal goals for 2021, what we would tweet our 12-year-old selves about 2020, providing we had social media when we were 12, and what our 2020 hashtags would be.
Also on this episode, we'll be giving our spoiler-free review on the first 3 books in the new High Republic series, and we also have the first Skywalker of the Month for 2021.
Or is it Skywalkers, plural?
Ooh.
Now, for such a big show and the first show in 2021, we couldn't do it alone, so we brought in reinforcements.
Yes, so the Skywalking Through Neverland book reviewer, you may know him as Jocasta Drew. We know him as Jocasta Drew too, but he also goes by his birth name, Drew Kaplan. Hey, Drew!
Hey, Richard and Sarah.
Yay! Well, how has the new year been treating you so far these 3 days?
It's off to a good start.
Nice.
All right, can you tell all the Skywalkers what you've been working on lately? Any projects?
Absolutely. So, you know, The Mandalorian's been great, both for my website, but also for videos. A lot of people are, especially more peripheral fans, have been wanting to know more about all these different things, The Mandalorians. And so that's been really great for even just my friends asking me and me providing content for them to explain these things. So that's been really fascinating these last 2 months with the second season of Mandalorian.
Well, you mentioned your website, but you didn't mention where we could go to go to your website.
That's true.
Always get a plug.
There we go. StarWarsMaven.info and the YouTube channel is Star Wars Maven. And so is Instagram and Twitter, Facebook. So, yeah, I mean, for me, 2020 has been really great the last 2 months. A lot of videos around The Mandalorian and various issues, because that's where people's attention is resting these days.
What's been your favorite subject about The Mandalorian?
So it's funny.
Don't say Grogu, okay? Got to look past that.
To be honest, I'm super excited about the expanding of the myth, both with The Mandalorians and with the Darksaber. And for me, that's been really fantastic. And I know I was on an episode of Skywalking Through Neverland talking about these topics. And so for me to see these come now and further developments has been really exciting for me.
Fantastic.
That and on top of finding a little bit more about Boba Fett's background.
That was awesome.
We also have from laughingplace.com and the host of Who's the Bossk Podcast, Mike Celestino.
Hey, Mike.
Hey guys, thanks for having me. Happy New Year to all of you. This is a fun way to kick off the 2021. I'm very excited to be here.
Well, yeah, you are so gracious to invite us on your Laughing Place big fun, what was that called? Mandalorian like season wrap up, right?
Yeah. I was glad to have you guys there. You're always you always have a lot to contribute. So it was definitely a fun. It went to almost an hour beyond what I wanted it to be, but I'm sorry for that, but I do think it was a lot of fun, so thank you for joining me.
And if we didn't have to cut out, we'd still be talking now.
It's true.
And you can't go wrong with a name like Who's the Bossk, one of the best bounty hunters, and I can't wait until he joins the Mandalorian.
Even if he doesn't show up on the Mandalorian, I have a feeling Bossk might be a part of the Boba Fett Book of Boba Fett TV show, right? Like, ooh, why not bring in some of the other bounty hunters there in live action? I think that would be awesome.
Oh, very much so. All right, Mike, how did you say goodbye to 2020?
You know what? I was asleep before midnight on the 31st, so I did not do anything too special. We did go for a nice hike in Griffith Park on New Year's Day, though. The next day we hiked up in the hills on Griffith Park. We saw some deer and some coyotes and stuff, so it was neat in that way. But other than that, nothing too special.
That brings to mind a meme that we saw go circulating on New Year's Eve, which was Baby Yoda, three different versions of Baby Yoda. One was like before midnight, and it was like Baby Yoda just kind of chilling. On midnight, and it was Baby Yoda in the plane, like, wee, you know, doing that. And yeah. Then 12:01 a.m., it was Baby Yoda passed out.
Well, you know, we tried to come up with a good New Year's Eve movie to watch.
Ooh.
That's, like, themed to New Year's Eve. And the best one we could come up with was When Harry Met Sally, because there's a few New Year's scenes in that. So we did watch that. And then we watched City Slickers right after that. So we kind of had a Billy Crystal marathon.
That's hilarious. We
should have done a watch party.
Yeah.
So we watched When Harry Met Sally.
Okay, okay. Yes.
I guess that's the one to go to, right?
Yeah. What about you, Drew? Did your family watch any movies or do anything on New Year's Eve?
For New Year's, we played it pretty quiet here. Kids went, I think our older two kids, we let them stay up until midnight. But my wife and I, this was one of the few New Year's we actually did stay up till midnight. We typically turn in a little bit earlier.
Yeah, we were in Arizona at Sarah's parents, and we were forcing ourselves to stay up until midnight.
Yeah.
At 11:50, if someone had said, let's just call it, we all would have been like, yeah, that's fine too. All right, Mike, for those of us who don't know about Who's the Bossk, and I can't imagine anyone not knowing about Who's the Bossk at this point.
Oh, I can imagine that.
No, it's a great show. Give us a synopsis and where they can find Who's the Bossk.
Well, okay. I'll tell you, about a year ago, I was having a conversation with my boss over at laughingplace.com about wanting to start a Star Wars podcast and what I wanted it to be, because the sequel trilogy had just ended with The Rise of Skywalker. And I thought we were entering into this very interesting period in Star Wars history where I felt like the creators were going to have a little bit more freedom to explore different periods of the timeline and stuff like that, now that they didn't have to worry about stepping on, you know, J.J. Abrams's toes or whatever. So I wanted to talk to a different guest each week about what was happening in Star Wars that week, and then pick like a different topic to discuss. So that's basically what the show is, just an excuse for me to talk with different guests and people that I know or people that I like, or other people like you guys. Not that I don't know and like you guys, but other people from the Star Wars fan community and podcast hosts, YouTubers. Occasionally we'll get a celebrity guest like James Arnold Taylor. I've talked to a bunch of the Star Wars authors, including the High Republic authors on the show. And it's just that every week, it's just me. If you enjoy hearing me talking, which I guess who doesn't? No. if you enjoy hearing me talking in this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland, go and check out Who's the Bossk. It's an hour or so every week of me talking about Star Wars.
And they can find that where?
Laughingplace.com, or just look up Who's the Bossk Pod on Twitter, or just type in Who's the Bossk, B-O-S-S-K, in anywhere you get your podcast, basically.
Cool.
All right. And once again, I couldn't more highly recommend your show.
Well, thank you. Thanks very much. I love you guys as well. And I'm so happy to be even considered to be part of the Star Wars fan community in that way.
Aww.
And that you are. All right. With that, now let's go skywalking through 2020.
When 2020 started, it was supposed to be my year. So what happened? I must trust that next year will be easier, and that we'll have each other's backs. Then I'll finally get to go out, and I'll let the whole world see my mouth. I believe that next year will be better for all of us. I believe.
All right, so it's time to bring up our fandom highlights of 2020. So you know what? Drew, Jocasta Drew, let's hear from you. What are your fandom highlights?
How many do we get?
35.
Great. I'll roll with that. Obviously, Mandalorian Season 2 was fantastic in the way it was, like, production values and storytelling was incredibly better than the first season. I also, it seems like 10 years ago, but the 7th and final seasons of The Clone Wars finally came out. I still remember being at Star Wars Celebration Anaheim in 2015 and just hungering and desiring this more. We wanted more, and finally we got the Siege of Mandalore, which was incredible to see in that season. And so those were fantastic.
Okay, Mike Celestino.
So I put my Star Wars stuff later in the list under what met expectations, but I'm going to talk about a few TV shows that we got into during the lockdown, because obviously there weren't a tremendous amount of things to do this year, but we did find solace in kind of exploring what was available on the small screen. So we did love the TV show Perry Mason, the detective noir show on HBO. Really great. And then we don't watch a lot of reality TV, but there were a couple reality competition shows that we got into in a big way. My wife and I loved Lego Masters, which a Star Wars episode with R2-D2 and C-3PO and BB-8 showed up. So that was really cool. Love that show. It did get renewed for a second season. So,
oh, good.
Hopefully they'll be shooting that soon if they're able to do it safely, and it'll come back, because I really enjoyed it. And then for a lot of fun, I would say tune into Holy Moly, which is a extreme mini golf show. And the two commentators on that, Rob Riggle and Joe Tessitore, I think his name is, are incredibly funny guys. And it's just really entertaining. And it cracked me up And I just highly recommend it.
I love that.
All right. I haven't heard of that one, but no. All right, put it on the list.
But Lego Masters, I'm glad you brought that up, because yeah, that was like super fun and exciting. And I follow one of the women on Instagram. Like, she makes bows, the one who always wore bows in her hair. Yeah. She like sells those. So you can go to her Instagram and like look at all she has available.
When I first heard of this show, I thought, okay, we'll watch one episode. And at the end of each episode, it's like, we can't wait for next week. Yeah. It's just so intriguing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I also started following some of the competitors on their personal YouTubes or Twitter and everything. And we were really rooting for the two guys with the beards who ended up coming in like second place.
Yeah.
Spoilers. But one of their YouTube channels is really fun. I'm blanking on the name of it right now. But if you look them up and find his YouTube channel, it's really a good subscribe.
Cool.
And you can't go wrong with Will Arnett. I just love hearing his voice, since he is Lego Batman.
I know.
Yes. Very funny guy.
All right, Sarah, what were your highlights of 2020?
Okay, so similar to Mike, I'm kind of going to go off Star Wars, because I know, Richard, you probably have a lot of Star Wars things. So,
well, I did until Drew took them all.
That's okay. So one of the things I'm going to mention is Marvel 616. This is the Disney Plus series that kind of goes into Marvel comics, but it's like eight documentaries by eight different directors. So they're all completely different stories, including the second one, which made me cry, which is Higher, Further, Faster. And it's all about the women of Marvel, going all the way back to like the 70s and I think even the 60s. And it's fascinating. And then also right now, I haven't even watched through the whole season 3, but Star Trek Discovery has just been incredible. I love this series. And they are doing something similar to what High Republic does in Star Wars, which is take the series and put it in a time that like nothing has happened yet. So it's kind of like tabula rasa, blank slate, and they can do what they want. So I'm really liking that. And also for representation purposes too. Like they've just doing some really incredible things with their casting. And then also I would say Comic-Con at home would it be a highlight, because we got to experience Comic-Con at home without all the crowds and everything.
Yeah, that's pretty much the only way to enjoy it these days.
And so,
I'm sorry, cosplayers.
Well, it's definitely a different energy, but I liked the fact that I could intake it at my own pace and in my own space, and yet still connect with people online through like Twitter or other ways. So that those would be my highlights.
Okay. I had some highlights, but once again, they were taken by Drew.
Uh-oh.
The Mandalorian season 2 and the final season of the Clone Wars, just seeing that siege of Mandalore was just phenomenal. Because I love anything that makes you look at the films a little bit differently now. Mm. I've seen Revenge of the Sith. I've lost count after like 100 times. But now when you watch it, you're going to watch it in a whole new way, because you're going to know that at this part, Ahsoka was fighting Darth Maul, and at this point, this happened, at this point, and this happened, and seconds before the film started, Anakin was talking with Ahsoka and Obi-Wan, and Anakin was giving back the lightsabers to Ahsoka. So I just love a whole new spin. But I also got to give a huge shout out to the movie Soul. Mm. And I'm so happy that Disney released it on Disney+. This was a phenomenal film. I wasn't sure how I was going to take it. It's all about jazz. Of all the music genres, jazz would be like below a Gregorian chant. But I really got into this. The themes were great, about just making the most of your time. The characters. Tina Fey was fantastic. I didn't even know it was her until Sarah, you said something. Like,
oh, yeah.
Hey, that sounds like Liz Lemon. And just the whole artistic style of it. I just didn't want the movie to end. And I didn't fall asleep.
Oh, that's very true.
I normally fall asleep during animated movies, but this one here just hooked me. And I could say afterwards, like, okay, maybe I'll move jazz up a few more notches.
Nice.
So I would say Soul is up there in my highlights of 2020. Also, I'm going to say the Disney investor call, where we got 102 Star Wars series coming our way.
Yes.
And
yes.
It's going to be
and Marvel.
It's going to be and Marvel
yes.
too.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It's going to be fun to see what actually sticks.
Yeah. Oh, I know, goodness. Right?
Yeah.
we vowed to go back a year later and see whether these things are all still on track.
Yeah. It's like, hey, where'd Rogue Squadron go? he did not just go there.
Oh.
Oh.
Wow.
All right. Now, those were the fandom highlights, but how about personal fandom highlights? Something you created, a new channel, a new podcast, a new something where you heightened your fandom. So, Mike Celestino. I'm sorry, I just can't say Mike. I gotta say Mike Celestino.
That's fine. You know, there's a song called Mike Celestino, What Have You Done With Star Wars? That you guys should Google after this, and it'll get my name stuck in your head for a long time. My personal highlights, I had some good ones this year. Before the pandemic struck, we got to do Star Wars Day at Sea on the Disney Cruise Line, and it was an incredibly fun time. I didn't really know what to expect. We had never done a Disney cruise before, but they had just so many fun things planned. We played a lot of trivia on the cruise, and I ended up winning the ultimate fan showdown on the Disney Cruise Line Star Wars Day at Sea. So that was a blast. And then they had, you know, all the costume characters walking around. They did this thing where Darth Vader like takes over the ship. And then all day long, you know, one of the 7 days of the cruise is dedicated to Star Wars. And all throughout that day, they just play the scores, the John Williams scores over the PA systems. So it's just so cool to be like that immersed in Star Wars for that long. And then, of course, I launched Who's the Bossk? In February of 2020. So I was very proud to follow through on that. I had done some pilots for podcasts before and they never kind of went anywhere. So I was happy that I managed to do like 40 something episodes in 2020. And I hope that will continue for the foreseeable future, enjoying doing that quite a bit. And then finally, since you mentioned things that we might have created, I did finish editing a documentary that I had shot several years ago, a short documentary called Lapse, L-A-P-S, which is about my friend John Allen Hale, who is the world record holder for most times ever on a Disney attraction. Specifically, it is the Radiator Springs Racers attraction at Disney California Adventure in Cars Land. He's done it over 12,000 times now. And it's a 17-minute documentary about why and how he did that. You can search for that on YouTube. It's called Laps, L-A-P-S. Just type in Laps documentary. I think it's usually the first result. And I hope you enjoy it. I enjoyed making it and glad that I finally finished it this year.
Awesome. And I bet he was the Radiator Springs spy like 1,200 times. Nice. I think I can pretty much parallel that for Star Tours.
Right.
But once again...
Haven't been the spy.
Spy just eludes me.
It's true.
All right, Sarah, what are your personal fandom highlights this year?
Well, again, because of the pandemic, you know, several things have happened, including I basically started up a mask business in like a day with the help of my mom and my friend Teresa Delgado. And yeah, we've been like for 2 months, I was pretty much sewing nonstop, outfitting all of my fandom friends and podcast listeners and everybody with face masks. And then we donated over 400 face masks. So that was really, really exciting. And that has since kind of formed a new business, Sarah Woloski Designs, which is an online business, and that might even be evolving more this year. So stay tuned, Skywalkers. So that's been very exciting. And then I'd have to say a personal highlight, you know, when you're in the pandemic, you're stuck at home, you got to have like comfort food. And not only did we have some comfort food, but we bought some comfort things. So I bought like a bunch of fandom makeup, including a little Baby Yoda thing, compact and all kinds of stuff that I've been enjoying actually having time to watch YouTube makeup videos and like learning how to do my makeup better. And I taught my mom how to do her makeup better. So we had some fun girl time over the holidays. So those are some personal highlights.
Speaking of comfort food, raise your hand if you had gained the COVID-15.
We're all raising our hands.
I definitely gained it. And then I made a a effort to lose it. So I have successfully done that.
We've made efforts to lose it. It hasn't happened yet. Eating dinner salads for an afternoon does not work.
But very, very good. Yeah. Well, we did kind of the same. We ate a lot, then we lost a lot, then we ate some more. So now.
Now we're going to lose some.
Yeah.
All right. Oh, is that it?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to say, when June 15th and we heard the word that Star Wars Celebration was being canceled, we had Force Fest chambered and ready to go. So we had combined our efforts with a lot of other podcasters like Tyler Bucks from Chatter Squadron and Frank D. Rich from Star Wars Autographs. And we just took charge and putting together Force Fest, celebrating the saga, which was our answer to Star Wars Celebration. This was the virtual Star Wars convention. And it was a great experience. We learned so much about ourselves, about other people, about how to organize something virtually, because we have a great history of organizing live events, but now this is all virtual, and it is much, much different, especially when we're going onto a platform that is not as user-friendly like Zoom. Get Vocal is a great platform, but there's a couple more steps to get there. So there was a huge learning curve. Yes. But once we got there, it was so much fun. We had over 50 panels. We raised over $3,200 for Make-A-Wish Foundation.
Mm-hmm. And tons of podcasters and YouTube people. They all joined in. It was really cool.
Yeah, and I had pitched a lot of panels for Star Wars Celebration. And it's like, well, I'm gonna okay them all now for Force Fest because we're in charge. I did my Celebrating the Ewok Adventure with guests Eric Walker, who played Mace Tuwani, and Kevin Thompson, who played several Ewoks in the films.
Yep.
We had a great panel with J.W. Rinsler. We did one on the Star Wars Holiday Special and that documentary that's coming up. And we had one on Fandom Through the Generations, where we spoke with Craig Miller, who was there at the very beginning, and going to Dan Madsen, who took over the next wave of Star Wars fandom, to Mark Daniel, who is the Celebration host, and he's got a whole different angle on fandom because he is the stage host. So he sees a lot of the family aspect and where it's going and where it is at that point. And that's a whole new live experience angle that I really wanted. And we did another panel, Navigating Fandom Through Disabilities, which was a very big eye-opener for a lot of people because no one really knew of the troubles that people with special needs had to go to a Disney park or go to a convention. And since this, we've made friends with Greg Norman and Jack Vasfori, who had a group called Resilience Squadron. So I suggested to them, hey, let's make this a monthly thing so people know these stories, and let's do a podcast. And they just released their second episode on our ever-growing Skywalking Network.
Yes.
That was a mouthful.
I know, right?
Yeah. So that's another segue into another big fandom highlight is the growth of the Skywalking Network. And because of the lockdowns, it forced us to focus on other things, and we didn't expect for the network to grow the way it did, but yeah. We got the Resilience Squadron, Neverland Clubhouse podcast, which really focuses a lot on Disney by Kelly and Courtney Turkel, the Max Effects podcast. We already had Talking Apes and Classic Marvel Star Wars comics, and there's another podcast coming soon.
Yeah, they have to do with me and another girlfriend of mine.
Yeah, you've already mentioned this. Why don't you go ahead and, you know, that's a personal fandom highlight.
Well, but
go
that's
ahead.
Coming in 2021, but yes.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's very true. Yeah, okay, so, I'll ask you that question next year.
We'll tease that. No. Yeah, there you go. But yeah, well, okay, well, it's called Totally Tell Me Everything, and it has a podcast jingle, which is very exciting.
Written by?
Rob Dellinger.
The?
John Williams of podcasting.
See, we finish each other's
Sandwiches. Nice.
All right. So let's move on to another category.
Yes.
All right. So.
Okay. Well, let's not to bring it down, but what didn't meet your expectations in 2020 fandom wise? Because I know we have to, like, have that caveat.
Yeah, we do. All right. Drew, what didn't meet your expectations in 2020?
Nothing. I mean, the two main things that we got hit on cylinders, like I mentioned, both The Mandalorian and The Clone Wars, and we didn't... I mean, I guess the good news was that we didn't have any movies come out this year, so that actually worked in our favor. We had some solid TV stuff come out, and like I told you before, I am stoked for 2021 and what's coming our way. So I'm really excited.
See, that's why we have Drew on. He's very, very positive.
I love it.
Just wait until our answers.
Yeah. Well, should we actually, Richard, do you want to go and say what didn't meet your expectations?
Okay, Sarah, can you leave the room, please? Wonder Woman 1984.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, there you go. Yeah. And we were all ready to love this movie. And it took place in 1984, although you would never know it took place in 1984. If you don't play Duran Duran, it ain't taking place in 1984. And it was a lot of fun to watch. But how many times do we need to pause it to say, wait, what? 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 How did this get here? And it just seemed like they shot a whole bunch of montages and they just edited them all together. And wait a minute, what's the bridge for each scene? Doesn't matter. Just keep on going.
I have to say, as a caveat to that, though, Richard, that I had a heck of a lot of fun watching it, and that it automatically gets a star because of Gal Gadot, then it gets another star because of Chris Pine, and then it gets another star because it's Wonder Woman. So it got three stars for me.
A fourth star? Pedro Pascal.
That's true. Well, yeah. In this one, he looks so weird. I don't know.
Okay. Weird.
But yeah.
We'll just call him the Econo Lex Luthor.
And there was a nice little love scene stuff that I appreciated. So I just don't want people going away thinking that I hated it.
Like, oh, no. This is my turn.
Oh, I'm sorry. All right. Well.
All right. So Christmas Day, that was the one thing that we were planning on doing and looking forward to doing it. But it took us like 5 hours to watch this 2.5 hour movie because we had to stop it and, you know what, Google this. Why is this happening over here? Why did Wonder Woman need this big gold eagle suit when she hardly ever used it and it didn't do much of anything? Why did Cheetah look so digital? Why? What happened to this when Steve Trevor took over this guy's body? What happened to this guy? Did his friends come looking for him? Like, hey, where's this guy? Where's his friend? Who came to
his
apartment.
He's Chris Pine, okay?
We came to the apartment. All of a sudden, the Gal Gadot is here, and the guy who looks like Captain Kirk. Where's our friend?
He's cute. I don't care.
See, but you know what? It's
that must have been a really interesting weekend for you, because the same weekend WWE 84 came out was also Soul.
Yes.
Yes.
So it's a very interesting weekend.
But we were made to watch Wonder Woman first because it has such a great predecessor with Wonder Woman.
Indeed. Yeah.
And they had this was going to come out in June and then October. They had several months to look at it and go, ooh, yeah, all right, maybe we can retinker this to make it make sense.
That's okay.
There you go. All right, said it. We don't have to go back there ever again.
Okay.
And I'll be sleeping on the couch.
All right. Should we go to Mike? Or
sure, Mike.
Yeah? Okay.
Well, Rich took the one that I had just come up with, but I'll say Christopher Nolan's Tenet. I used to love Christopher Nolan, one of my favorite filmmakers in my early 20s, but the last few have been kind of lacking for me. And this one was just very convoluted. And there were some cool things about it, but overall, I thought it was just okay, which is a bummer because I always used to really look forward to his films. Have you guys seen that one?
No, I don't even know what it's about.
It's about 3 hours long.
It's kind of a spoiler to even know that, but
okay.
Yeah. It's a big high concept sci-fi action movie. The cast is good. It looks really cool, but it's one of those where you might have to watch it 3 or 4 times to even really understand it. And I'll go back and check it out again, but it's just not even close to the top of my list of his movies.
I wasn't a fan of his Batman movies, so I'm not a big fan of his.
Okay.
Hold on. We're getting a lot of hate emails right now. How could you not like Christopher Nolan?
I like the first two of his Batman movies. I did not like the third one. Mm.
The one that was like three different movies in one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, fade out. Or we could tell the story of another character.
Right?
Fade out now. But hold on. We didn't tie this up. You don't need to.
All right. Well, I did not say what didn't meet my expectations, so I will say that now. And it's really funny because even though it was a highlight, Comic-Con at Home did not meet my expectations in terms of the amount of like the big panels and also the fact that the panels were not live. So like that was kind of a big bummer because a lot of what we were trying to plan, and we can't, Comic-Con at Home came out like right when we were planning Force Fest.
That came out in July.
Right.
And Force Fest was August.
So we were planning Force Fest.
Yes.
And we were trying to figure out like what to do. So Comic-Con at Home was like, oh, I'm going to check this out and see what, you know, was good or bad. And yeah, the thing, the fact that basically on YouTube would just publish a pre-recorded video at a pre-planned time. And then you could like tweet about it with people when it was happening, but it wasn't actually happening. Like the panelists weren't actually like doing that at that moment. So I kind of was a little disappointed in that. And then also, and I know
I was going to add this comment in, Comic-Con at Home, hold Force Fest spear.
Oh, man. All right. Well, and then also they didn't have like a ton or really any big panels, like any Star Wars, Marvel or film panels. I feel like Disney Investor Day should have been like at Comic-Con at Home. That would have been pretty amazing, except they didn't have all that info yet, you know, what, 4 or 5 months before that. So yeah, that was kind of a bummer. But if they could do it again next year, I hope that Comic-Con has, or even when it becomes live again, like you can go again, I hope they keep a streaming element to it. And we had Eric Unkenhout, who lives in Boston. He was able to cover half of the panels with me because, and from his own home because of Comic-Con at Home. So there was good and bad, but I was a little disappointed in the whole thing.
The fact that it wasn't live really,
yeah.
It was a check mark in the, what could you do better next time?
Right, right.
Mike, what did meet your expectations in 2020?
Well, I wanted to bring up another Star Wars thing that we haven't talked about yet, which is the Rise of the Resistance attraction that opened at Disneyland in 2020, very early 2020, then only operated for a very brief time before getting shut down. But I was really looking forward to that ride, and I thought they did a fantastic job putting that whole thing together, and I'm sure you guys enjoyed it as well. But yeah, I'm looking forward to going back on that thing.
And I want to thank Disney once again for opening that ride on my birthday. Well, we had the press event on January 16th, and the ride officially opened here at Disneyland on January 17th.
The day after your birthday.
Yeah, so but Disney, still, thank you very much. I really appreciate that. All right, Drew, so we'll ask you the same thing. What did meet your expectations?
I was very pleased with Mandalorian and Clone Wars. I mean, I feel like I'm beating a, you know, drum, but I was happy with those. Those were great. Those are solid.
Okay.
Those, yeah.
Sarah, what met your expectations?
Like Mike, I really think it was Rise of the Resistance. I mean, it was just such an amazing experience. I would say it exceeded expectations, really.
So you guys keep taking all my choices.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I'm going to throw this in here then.
Okay.
I'm going to say what met my expectations. And like you just said, Rise of the Resistance exceeded your expectations. I'm going to say friends coming together for our virtual trick-or-treat video exceeded my expectations.
Right. Yeah, that was so cute.
Yeah. I want to thank everyone for coming together and giving us a little bit of a Halloween treat. So we can't go trick-or-treating in person. Got to do it virtually.
Yeah.
And it was a great thrill to put that together and seeing everyone put in their videos and seeing their creativity.
Papes. You want papes. And you have to watch the video to know why that's funny.
Yeah, get that what I mean, yeah. Another thing that went beyond my expectations was the re-release of The Empire Strikes Back and all the 40th anniversary celebrations around The Empire Strikes Back.
That is amazing.
All right, so now let's go on to what did we miss in 2020?
Aww.
All right, Sarah, do you want to start us off with this one?
Sure. When you asked me this question originally, it would be Star Wars Celebration.
Mm-hmm.
That the thing that pops to mind the fastest. We did not get that. It would have been right here in our own backyard in Anaheim. And we had a lot of fun plans. So, 2 years. Actually, next year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
2022.
Okay. It was great that after Force Fest, a lot of people said, we didn't even miss Celebration. That was like the best compliment we could ever get. All right, Mike, what did you miss in 2020?
Yeah, Star Wars Celebration was my big one, and other conventions that got canceled. I loved Force Fest. I had a fantastic time participating in that and watching a ton of the other panels as well. But it's just not the same as being there in person and interacting with other fans. But since you already said the convention thing, I'll say the theme parks. I also terribly miss going to all my favorite theme parks, including the Disney parks, Universal Studios, Hollywood. We did get some Knott's Berry Farm in there, but it wasn't the same as well because the rides weren't operating. But it was nice to at least be able to go to one of the parks and walk around in a strange way. But I can't wait to go back to the parks again.
I had a dream last night that we were all at Disney.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh, it's a dream I have every night.
Aww.
All right. So, Drew, what do you say?
Number one. Obviously, as you mentioned, these various in-person celebrations, not only Star Wars Celebration, but just really anything. And in addition to like big fan gatherings, even getting together with other fans to celebrate things. Imagine if we had, even for The Mandalorian or really even for The Clone Wars, to get together with fellow folks and really not having those opportunities. The other thing is the MCU being pushed out off. We're supposed to have Black Widow come out this year. And we still haven't seen it. So I'm still hungering for more MCU content.
Yeah, and The Eternals was supposed to come out November 6th of this year as well.
Yeah. And Avengers Campus here at Disney's California Adventure.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. We're like, what, a month away from that opening?
Yeah. Oh. It's supposed to be in May.
Yikes. So I can say that was my big miss of 2020. That and Ghostbusters. That was the one film I was looking forward to seeing, was the new Ghostbusters film.
Well, we did miss some things, but honestly, because of the pandemic, some things were changed for the better. So, you know what? Let's see. What was changed for the better, according to you guys? How about you, Mike?
I am going to have a very controversial one, and I'm going to say that I love the pivot to streaming for the release of big movies, because many years prior to the pandemic, I was rooting for the death of movie theaters, because it used to be my favorite thing in the entire world to go and watch a movie in a movie theater with a big crowd. And it got completely ruined for me by the invention of the smartphone. And you know what? At this point, I would rather just sit at home, enjoy it in the peace and quiet of my living room, my nice big screen TV. And and also I think it's going to encourage smaller scale storytelling like The Mandalorian, as opposed to big, gigantic blockbuster movies like The Rise of Skywalker, which I did not like as much as I love The Mandalorian. And, you know, when the budgets go down, the stories become more intimate. And I think that's going to encourage a positive change in this kind of storytelling going forward.
Wow. I couldn't have said it better myself in one regard for, yeah, what was changed for the better? Watching entertainment. Like you, Mike, I hate going to the movies. I really do, because you can't enjoy the movie because this guy over here, he's texting his friend. She over there, she's talking to her friends and they're texting each other. And one person down below has their phone on. They don't turn the light off. The guy behind you is wrinkling his Twizzler cellophane wrapper.
I can get past the candy wrapper.
No, I can't. And now when they start serving nachos, Sarah, I think we were seeing Star Trek Into the Darkness. Guy behind me, it's like, are you mic'd? The crunching was so loud. And then we would turn back. And you hope the death glare would get him. But no, he'd look back at you like, what?
Or someone kicking your seat.
And the same movie, Sarah, the guy in back of you had a water bottle. And he would keep squeezing it. Don't you hear that? Don't come on.
And then X-Men, the movie, the final Logan. Oh, Logan was completely ruined for us. The death scene, because these guys were talking.
Yeah, we saw the movie A Quiet Place the horror movie A Quiet Place in the theater, which there's a lot of parts in that movie that are supposed to be completely quiet.
It's in the title.
Yeah, and the kids, the like teenagers in the row in front of us, were watching WWE on their phones with the audio on. And the guy next to me like got completely furious and yelled at them. And then he apologized to me for having yelled at those kids. And I was like, listen, man, I'm on your side. You just had the courage to say something about it. And I was sitting here just fuming. So, too many experiences like that have turned me off of movie theaters for sure.
Yeah. But I would disagree that we'll be seeing smaller storytelling, because I think with now we get 8 episodes of a story, we get bigger storytelling. So instead of trying to jam a story in 2.5 hours, we can now spread it out over 8 episodes, giving it a bigger story and much more room to develop.
I guess when I said smaller, I just meant like more intimate, you know, more character driven and less giant explosion action scenes, which The Mandalorian has action scenes, obviously. But I do feel like I have a more of a connection to the characters than I do just waiting for the next thing to blow up or whatever.
Right.
All right. All right. I get that.
Definitely agree with you.
So when I started to hear the words out of Michael's mouth about the pivot from, you know, more streaming stuff, I got very excited. I don't know that I necessarily want to go all the movies out of the theaters route, but definitely for me, hearing more, especially from the Disney Investor Day, more storytelling on the small screen with these series, even the, you know, that for me is really exciting. I think partly because I've not really been happy with the recent movies being told, at least in Star Wars, but at the same time, I'm excited, for the series. I'm going to be super stoked for the Bad Batch, but also even for the MCU. And I'm really excited for those stories and those characters to be more fully developed over the course of these multiple episodes rather than just packed into a movie. So for me, and not just Star Wars, but MCU especially, I'm really excited to see this huge pivot towards online streaming.
Oh, yeah. And next week, what's today? The third? In 2 weeks, we're going to be seeing WandaVision, which I'm very excited about. All these new shows that we're getting because of streaming, and what did the Disney officials say, that they're going to focus more on streaming and home entertainment?
Yeah. Like,
thank you. Thank whoever I need to thank, Mickey Mouse or Bob Iger, Kathleen Kennedy, anyone over at Disney. Please, thank you very much for doing this.
Absolutely. Yes. All right. Well, okay. So what was changed for the better for me? I've got to say that we were able to connect a lot more with Skywalkers, like through on a weekly basis through Zoom and through our online trivia, which we do every Friday, and our pop culture trivia. And then it's just really nice to be able to connect. Like, we would have never started this weekly pop culture trivia without the pandemic, without everyone home. Mm-hmm. And we do that on Friday nights because people can't really go out much on Fridays. And we have a good number of folks tuning in every week and writing their own trivia now and just having a fun time just connecting with each other, be it via comments. Sometimes we do it on Zoom just to have more of a personal connection. But I've really enjoyed that.
Yeah, our Skywalker meetups were once every couple of months, but now it's once or twice a week.
Yep.
So I can say for me, that was changed for the better. And our pop culture trivia plug, every Friday night at 6:30 p.m. Pacific time has just been so fantastically fun. And we got a good group of people. We change up the categories. It's not just Star Wars or Marvel or Disney. It's Harry Potter. It's A Christmas Story. It's Mary Poppins. It's commercials from the 80s. It's a whole bunch of really fun stuff, which we wouldn't have done if things had been going the way
they normally would,
right? Exactly.
Yes.
All right. So, Mike, what would be your hashtag for 2020?
Okay, I have a few. My first one is hashtag the year without a Comic-Con, though we already kind of covered that. My second one is hashtag the year our cats got sick of us. And the third one is hashtag the year we got sick of us.
Wow.
Okay, I need to delve into this. How did your cats get sick of you? How do you know?
Do you guys have cats?
We have bunnies.
Okay. I've had them before.
You know, cats like their alone time every once in a while. And we're just home, both of us, all the time, every day. And they're just like, when are you guys going out again? When is that going to happen? So, looking forward to regaining our cats' respect again in 2021.
On those times when you do go out, you ever find a copy of The Secret Life of Pets on your desk? It's like, let's live more like this. Okay, once a week is not enough.
They have not seen The Secret Life of Pets yet. We should.
Oh, I'm sure they have. All right, Drew Kaplan.
So more broadly, we could talk about either hashtag Grogu, Year of Grogu, certainly something along the lines of Mando, more Mando.
Your Mando.
I do. I mean, I think for me, it's really driven not only my Star Wars fandom recently as far as, but really hearing it from other people who are more peripherally fans. And for them, it's really ignited their interest in Star Wars. So that's been fascinating for me to experience. And then on top of that, it would be something along the lines of more videos that I really hadn't produced so many videos in the last 5-6 years. And then it's been an explosion for me, certainly in the last 2-3 months. So it's been really exciting.
Okay, so hashtag Grogu is what you're going to go with.
I'll go with fine. The year of Grogu.
Hashtag Baby Yoda finally got a name.
Yeah.
Hashtag take that frog lady.
Oh.
All right, Sarah. What
and
would be
frog man. Frog
and
man.
Frog man. And the proprietor, the Weequay proprietor and...
Mithril.
Yeah, Mithril.
All right, don't get me started on the names. All right. My hashtag for 2020 would be hashtag be afraid, but do it anyway. This is the Carrie Fisher quote. I love this quote so much. And it's kind of what I have taken since we started planning Force Fest has been kind of my mantra. So it is now a hashtag.
Okay. Very, very nice. My hashtag would be hashtag just keep swimming. As much as 2020 try to throw viruses and all this other nonsense at us, just keep going. Just keep going. I also want to add in hashtag Trump can't take down TikTok.
Oh. You know what? And I want to add a hashtag from Zootopia. Hashtag try everything. That should be the theme song.
Yeah, pretty much so. All right. Do you have a personal goal for your fandom in 2021, Jocasta Drew?
So I've got two. The first of which is I haven't read every single book. I still have a handful more books to catch up on that are Star Wars canon. So that's one of them. The second is to make more videos and to be more of a resource for my fellow fans.
No.
That was very good. Very good goals. Fandom All right. goals.
You know what? I'm going to piggyback off of that.
Okay.
Because I've been working on a project since 1977, and I've just completed a new draft of it, and this is Today in Star Wars History. Oh. Ever since I was a kid, I've always loved dates, and I've written down dates, birthdays, but as I got older, it's like, I understand now about releases and books and such. And wherever I was, if I saw a date, I would just scribble it down until I had like pages and pages and pages. And at this point, I've got over 450 pages full of Today in Star Wars History. And I've been encouraged by a lot of author friends. This should really be a good resource book. And that's what one of my goals is, because a lot of stuff I find online, a lot of information, some of it is incorrect. Because why this has taken so long, and I've been working on this really every day for the last, I would say, 4 years, because I would look something up and then I would always cross-reference that. It's like, wait a minute, why are these two dates differently? So I would just go down these rabbit holes, go, oh, I see where you got your information, and I see where you got your information, and then find out what that real specific date is. And I'm hoping to correct a lot of stuff that's online. And I've even had to reach out to some some authors, some publishers, and say, hey, this website has like the Return of the Jedi radio adaptations. Those release dates are all over the place. So I said, all right, I'm just going to reach out to the manufacturer, to the publishing company. They said, oh, no, it's this date here. So, okay, all right. So going on what you said, Drew, I hope this could be a really good resource for people looking to do research on Star Wars, because I've done my homework again and again and again. And I've got a lot of friends like Michael Cote or Bob Miller or Craig Miller, people who were actually there, or they themselves are pretty hardcore when it comes to actual facts. And I got a lot of their help just to make sure that everything here is going to be 100% accurate. And I just my New Year's resolution was to finish this by December 31st. And like with 3 hours to spare, I finished up my last edit.
Like draft.
Wow. My last draft. Fact check. Yes. Yeah, that's what I meant. Yes.
And fact check. Yeah.
And now the High Republic comes and it's like, oh, I got to write all this stuff down now too. Yes, but there were a lot of dates from the 70s and 80s that weren't published or really accurately had a good citation to it. So I had to call companies and find out stuff.
Wow.
And every single entry has got a citation. So if anyone says, wow, no, wait a minute. And because our good friend Russell Flores, who wrote the Seen Unseen Disney books, he'll say, I've been to conventions and people will come up for a book and they'll challenge me on something.
Ah.
And as I thought, oh, wait a minute. Okay, so I want to write down every citation. So if someone says, wait a minute, this didn't happen then, I can say, but look, I got 4 or 5 citations that lead up to this one fact.
Right. Wow. It's very good.
Yeah, so hoping to have it done by August for a release for Christmas time, 2021.
That's great.
All right, so Mike, do you have a personal goal in your fandom?
Yeah, I've got a few. I want to travel more. Of course, I was traveling a lot for my job prior to everything shutting down, and I really, really miss it. Besides the cruise, I got to go to Disneyland Paris a couple times at the end of 2019, and that was awesome. And I was hoping to get to go to other like overseas Disney parks eventually, and Walt Disney World and stuff, and I really miss that. So that's definitely on there. Interacting with other fans again face-to-face, I think, would be high on my list. I really miss that. And then number 3 is playing more board games, because that's I really miss playing board games with people in person. We've done some over Zoom. It doesn't quite work as well, but it's still, you know, there's some that you can do that way. But I miss, you know, setting up the board and having everybody with their pieces and just getting in arguments and stuff. that's going to be something. As soon as we can again, we're going to be doing that very frequently.
You know, when you just said that, I just got a memory sense perception of smelling my old Parcheesi game. It had a particular smell to this game, like because the wood pieces had a particular smell. So when you said games, it just hit me. It's like, is my Parcheesi game somewhere in the room?
That's hilarious.
I was thinking more elaborate, you know, like Star Wars Imperial Assault or whatever, like hours and hours long board games where you need snacks and people sleep over at the end and stuff.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, fun.
I'm more simplistic. I'm thinking Sorry. I'm thinking Uno, Parcheesi, Chutes and Ladders. All right, Sarah.
Okay, well, for my personal goal in fandom, it's, you know, I've always been very creative and it's good to have an outlet for that creativity. And so this online store that was born from the mask making, I really want to be able to use my creativity to create and help forward an online store of some kind. So that is my personal goal, and I might be partnering with someone to do it, and I'll continue to tease that until I have more to tell about that. But yeah, so it's pretty exciting.
All right, then what are we each looking forward to in 2021? So Mike Celestino.
Well, I'm going to steal everybody's answers real quick. The Book of Boba Fett. More of the High Republic, since we've all read, I think, the first 3 novels. There are more coming out in the summertime. And then another big one for me outside of Star Wars is all the MCU stuff that we're going to get this year. It's like the year of Marvel. Outside of Avengers Campus opening at DCA that you mentioned earlier, there's all the streaming shows on Disney Plus, and then hopefully a couple of movies. I do enjoy the MCU on top of Star Wars as well. So those were mine.
So Sarah, make a note. Next year, everyone gets one, okay? Because Mike literally just took my whole list.
And mine. That's okay.
All right. Drew Kaplan.
Okay, so MCU. Obviously, I'm excited for all that stuff. Finally getting Black Widow. All the new streaming stuff. So that's MCU, which I'm, like, forgetting the Star Wars stuff. I'm just incredibly excited about that. And then when we get to Star Wars stuff, there's two things. One is, we have a lot of new shows, but for me, Bad Batch is really up there. I really am such a Clone Wars fan, and to have a sense of literal closure because of Order 66, but I'm curious to see how this Bad Batch develops even after the turn of the Republic into the Empire. So I'm really excited for that. So that's one piece. And totally different is I started reading this first Thrawn book, the Ascendancy, and it is phenomenal. It is incredible. And now I'm excited for the next book to come out in 2021. So for me, those are some things I'm stoked about 2021.
That's awesome.
All right, Sarah.
Oh, well, I mean, High Republic was one of mine, and so was WandaVision. I would definitely say those are up there. So those were already taken. So you know what? I will concede to you, Richard.
I'm going to say Ghostbusters. Is there an official title to this movie, or is it just Ghostbusters?
Afterlife.
Okay, good. And Black Widow. Now, what's the final word on Black Widow? It keeps going. It's all over the place. So
it's May, right? And it's May, and it's going to be the release where it's you pay $30. It's premiere access, right?
They haven't said that yet about Black Widow.
Oh,
We do know Raya and the Last Dragon is coming out that way. It.
Yes.
I wouldn't be surprised if that eventually happens for Black Widow as well, but they have not said.
It's going to happen. Come on.
Yeah.
All right. I'm also looking forward to more live Skywalker meetups. And I'm also looking forward to reading more of the original Spider-Man comic books.
Ooh.
I've read every single Star Wars comic on Marvel Unlimited, and the Spider-Man number one popped up from 1963. So I read this, like, I could have more of this. And they're just so much fun. These fun little simplistic. I'm a very simplistic guy. Very, very simple story. And this is back when they called Peter Parker Peter Palmer for two issues.
Huh?
And then issue number three, they changed it to Peter Parker, and no one ever said boo about it.
Well, guess what, Richard? There wasn't Twitter back then.
No. Or online hatred for everybody.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now, how about this one? Mike, if you could tweet to your 12-year-old self, what would you say about 2020? Providing you had social media back then, like Twitter.
Yeah, I'll say, don't worry, you will eventually see this guy right here, Boba Fett, in live action in the period after Return of the Jedi. That is going to happen. You're going to have to wait 28 years since you were 12, but it will happen. The only other thing is you'll have to stay inside most of that same year, but it will be worth it. I did, can't go wrong there. I did really enjoy that about 2020.
All right, Drew, if you could tweet your 12-year-old self, what would you say?
Be prepared for lots of different stuff.
Okay.
Be prepared.
Yes.
Yes. Right. Like the Boy Scouts motto, be prepared. Yeah.
Like nice. Scar saying.
Yes, that's what I was thinking. Okay. The Scar song.
Wait, wasn't that from
Lion King? Be prepared.
Okay, I was thinking of The Fly. Be afraid. Be very afraid.
No. Is that what you would tweet your 12-year-old self? Or what would you do?
I would tweet to myself, always wash your hands more than usual, and don't go on Twitter.
Oh, yes, that's a good one. For several reasons, yes.
Yeah, just if anything, just whatever you're looking at this on right now, throw it away. Throw it into the ocean, garbage disposal, whatever you got. Get a Bic lighter, take to it. That, and before you toss this in the garbage disposal, invest in Disney.
Yes.
All right, Sarah.
All right, I would tell myself, start trying new things now so you can practice for 2020. When you'll try a bunch of new things and do it in different ways.
That's something that everyone should be hearing right now.
Right?
Stop what you're doing and listen. Start trying new things. What do you predict your hashtag will be for 2021? Drew?
More videos. Straight to the point.
More videos on?
Mainly Star Wars, but who knows? It could be more stuff. Yeah, The Mandalorian. Boba Fett's coming out. People are going to want to know a lot about him, what's going on. So there's a lot of opportunity. And The Bad Batch. I'm going to be one of the most ridiculous fans about The Bad Batch. So
can I go one step further for you, Drew? Can your hashtag for 2021 be, this is what happens in a Sarlacc's belly?
Ooh, that's clever.
Yeah, because we don't know yet how we got out of there. So there you go.
Yeah, it's great.
All right, Mike.
I'm going to get a little emotional on you here. My hashtag for 2021, I hope, is hashtag crying because I stepped foot into Disneyland, which I really hope that happens. And if it does happen, if I do get to go back into Disneyland, I almost certainly will cry because I was going on a weekly basis for 5 years until the park shut down. And it's been now, 10 months or something more than that? 9-10 months. So that's what I'm really looking forward to.
There should be separate corrals once you enter Disney. For those of you who are going to cry, come over here. For those of you who are going to blubber, over here. And they'll be filled. They'll be filled. All right, Sarah.
So the thing that came to mind would be hashtag Marvel everything, just because I'm really into Marvel. I want to read more Marvel comics on the Marvel Unlimited. I'm just excited about, there's 3 Disney Plus series coming. So I'm just ready to, go all in on Marvel stuff.
I got to recommend the 1963 Spider-Man comic series.
Okay.
You're going to love it.
Okay.
I would say hashtag live Wookiee hugs. Because once we get our Skywalker meetups happening again, I'll be hugging everyone. So just get used to it. Not just any hugs, but big, giant Wookiee hugs. So wear a back brace, wear some body armor, because I need some live Wookiee hugs from the Skywalkers.
So do I.
All right, so that is Skywalking through 2020. So Mike and Drew, thanks a lot for sharing your thoughts and looking back. So let's just put 2020 in an urn. In a casket somewhere. Don't look back. And now let's move on to the High Republic.
Woo!
We are the guardians of peace and justice. Beyond the stars is a near endless frontier. Our order was meant to shine its light in even the darkest corners of the galaxy. There, we found an evil that none of us had trained for, that threatens all we know. For the survival of the Republic, the fate of all Jedi, for control of the Force itself.
Last February, we had gone to a High Republic press event, and we were so excited for all these new books and comics and YA novels coming, and, unfortunately, because of the pandemic, things have been pushed, but now they're finally here. So on January the 5th, we're going to get a whole slew of books, including the flagship book, Light of the Jedi by Charles Soule. Now, Sarah, this book sets the tone for the whole media campaign of the High Republic, right?
Well, this is the adult novel of the campaign, and there's a bunch of different novels. There's a YA novel, there's a middle grade novel, there's this little book right here that you have, The Great Jedi Rescue. There's a bunch of different ages, but this would be like the main adult novel that you can start with.
So we've been looking forward to this for about a year. So Mike, you've read the first 3 books.
Yes, correct.
And Drew, you read these first 3 books as well. Yes. So I'm the only one here who read this, the little golden book version. And so I'll have lots of questions. So let's review here. We'll go through the story and then we'll give our reactions. And let's keep it very spoiler free, because at this point, the week the show goes out, not everyone will have gone through each book in the little golden book.
Right, right. And then later on, we'll probably delve more into kind of the story. But for now, let's give everyone like an overview of what's happening, the characters, things like that.
But more on a general sense, people can go back to our episode last year when we did the whole breakdown of the High Republic from the information we knew then. But now we know a whole lot more.
Absolutely. So we're starting with Light of the Jedi by Charles Soule. And the story overview, this is what's happening in this novel. It's a golden age. It starts 200 years before the Skywalker Saga. And worlds under the Republic are flourishing. And the Jedi keep the peace and help expand the Senate and the High Republic's reach to the frontier. Starlight Beacon, it's a space station in the Outer Rim. This is about to open, which will extend the Republic's reach even further. But this is when a great disaster occurs, a shocking catastrophe in hyperspace, and the Jedi must work together to deal with the fallout and discover the cause of this hyperspace disaster. And meanwhile, a sinister threat starts to form on the edges of the galaxy in the form of the Nile, a group of marauders with a dark secret.
Awesome. All right, so once again, we covered the Project Luminous, which was the working title for the High Republic, on our episode 278. That'll give you a good general overview. But now, to dig a little deeper, let's get into the actual books. So, Mike Celestino, what is your reaction to this book, The Light of the Jedi?
Well, I was very excited when I heard the list of authors for this project, because Charles Soule, he is my favorite current Star Wars comic book author. I think he's doing an amazing job on the main Star Wars title from Marvel. He also wrote The Rise of Kylo Ren from Marvel. He did a run on Darth Vader, Dark Lord of the Sith. Those were all fantastic. And I was so excited that he was going to write his first Star Wars novel. And also we've got Claudia Gray, who has written some of my absolute favorite books in the current Star Wars canon. She's probably my favorite Star Wars novelist working right now. You know, she did Master and Apprentice, which was about Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon Jinn. Then she did Bloodline. Actually, that was earlier, but that took place later, and it was about Leia before the Force Awakens. And she also wrote Lost Stars. Great writer. So I was thrilled by the team, the creative team that they had put together for this project. My one big reservation about the High Republic in general is that I'm a huge, huge Star Wars fan, but I'm not the biggest fan of the Jedi as characters. I always think when you go back in time to when the Jedi are active, it gets kind of boring to me. Like, I always compare it to playing a role-playing game, actually. Like, if you're building a party in a role-playing game, you don't have all mages, you don't have all wizards, you know? Like, in Lord of the Rings, there's only one wizard, and the rest of the characters are all different classes or types, you know? In High Republic, it's a bunch of Jedi going on adventures together, and they're all Force users, so that's less interesting to me, because I think, not only that, they're all, like, good guys, they're all kind of bland characters, so I was worried about that, but knowing the talent involved, that got me excited about it. And I did enjoy this book, the introductory book, Light of the Jedi. I think it's a great jumping off point for the High Republic, because it introduces the threat, which is the Nile, the main villain faction. It introduces this thing called the Great Disaster that you kind of touched on in the synopsis there, and it introduces us to all the Jedi characters that we're going to be interacting with throughout the High Republic series. And we also get to know what's going on in the galaxy at this time, again, 200 years before the stories that we grew up with. So for that reason, as an introductory book, I think it really works very well. My wife's reading it right now. She calls it the High Republic pilot episode, which I think is accurate, again, comparing it to TV, because this is just giving us the groundwork and the characters and the locations and stuff. So it does a great job doing that.
Okay. All right, Jocasta Drew.
I really like Michael's framing of the pilot episode. I really think that Charles Soule really established a nice foundational framework for what's going to be going on once they establish this beacon. They call it the Starlight Beacon. So this space station that's out in the Outer Rim, I actually didn't know what's going to go on. But yeah, the establishment of this Nihil as the antagonist. And really, they operate in the Outer Rim. They really haven't been threatened by the Jedi. And the Jedi really haven't, or the Republic, really haven't interacted with them before. So this establishes where not only this legacy run incident, which really starts to change things, but also establishes their antagonistic relationship. So it's a great framework for everything going on. And so that's, I like it. Pilot episode.
All right. On a rating of 1 to 10, when someone says, Drew, you read Light of the Jedi, what kind of rating do you give it?
It's a solid, like, I don't know. It's not a bad book. It wasn't hard to get through, but it wasn't amazing, amazing, amazing. Like a, I don't know, 7 or 8. It's solid. But like I said, the main reason one would want to read this is it provides that foundational framework, that pilot episode aspect for what's going to be going on once the Starlight Beacon gets established.
Okay. All right. Sarah.
Yeah, similar. I love that word framework. It really does that. And I feel like Charles Soule does this by jumping around between different points of view in different characters. And so you really get kind of an overall sense and a general overview of the galaxy through mostly Jedi characters, except for like one Nihil character. But it's also kind of bad in that we don't get to know any single person really well or get very invested in their emotional journey. So I think maybe that's why it's not like a solid 10, because of that. Mm. Like, I was really hoping to dig into Avar Chris, who is the blonde Jedi you see right on the cover in the center. I'm super excited about her. She kind of sees the Force through music, and we knew that going in. So I was like, dude, this is like my character. And we didn't really get much from her. Like, we saw her really in just, like, I think 3 or 4 main scenes, but like, we didn't get to emotionally invest in her as much as I wanted to. However, I'm hoping this is like really only the beginning for her and that we'll get a book that focuses more on her. But I am going to talk about the overall like sense of how the book was constructed. And like, the first 100 pages deals with this great disaster and all these emergences that come from this great disaster. And I love, it's like, each chapter begins with a countdown to like impact, countdown to impact. And it just really makes you read and read and read. Like, you can't put this thing down. So I do love that. And it just lends this sense of urgency that you usually feel towards the end of the book, but instead it's at the beginning. So it's a great like way. It's a great, what is that called? Conceit. It's a great conceit. And then also, I mean, the book kind of turns into this almost like murder mystery kind of a thing, like mystery, like what's happened. So that kind of sees you through the second half of the book is what, how did this great disaster occur? And so I think it's a really good book, and I would probably give it a solid 8.5 to 9 because of the way it's constructed like that. And the fact that you get this overall great sense. And there are some really cool things, which I'll go into later, of passages that stuck out. So,
Mike, yeah. what grading would you give it? From 1 to 11?
I'll do a 7.5
okay.
Out of 10. If you're doing 11, it's going to be bumped up a little bit. But.
Okay. So you say that Avar Chris, she feels the Force through music. Is that like with Thrawn? He can figure out someone's cultural traits by just their art?
So I'm going to jump to passages that stuck out because this really isn't a spoiler. This is just kind of a layout of the world. But this is a passage from the book that I love. It says, "The Force sang to Jedi Master Avar Chris, a choir that was the entirety of the Hetzel system, life and death in constant contrapuntal motion. What Avar heard as a song, Elzar Mann, another Jedi, saw as a deep, endless, storm-tossed sea. The Wookiee, Buryaga, was a single leaf on a gigantic tree with deep-dug roots and sky-high limbs. Douglas Sunville saw the Force as a huge interlocked set of gears made of an endless variety of materials from crystal to bone. So each of these, this is the Force to them, but I love the way that he writes this, because if you think about it, like we all see different things differently, like time in my mind, you know, I see it a certain way. I'm sure you see it a certain way in your head. It's like, this is how they've constructed something that's not visual in their minds. You know, this is how each Jedi sees the Force. It's just to them. Like the Wookiee especially kind of makes sense. He sees it as a giant tree.
So I guess you could really compare it to like the seeing impaired. How they would imagine something.
Yeah, exactly. Like someone who's never seen anything.
Right. They construct their own visual perception of what that looks like.
Right, right.
Oh, okay. All right. Good to know. Once again, I haven't read these books, so it's good to know going in.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's how they sense the Force. That's, yeah.
I did read this little book that was intended for six-year-olds, which is great for me, and it's called The Great Jedi Rescue, and on the first couple of pages, they talk about the Great Disaster, and I don't think it's a spoiler to say what the Great Disaster is, because they just really brushed through it in all 10 pages. They couldn't really focus on the Great Disaster, so I had to ask you, what is the Great Disaster? And I think knowing this going in would really help readers
give a good primer?
A good primer, yes. And to know what that is, I think would really help. So you're not always going, what is this? Because when I started reading The Light of the Jedi, I kept seeing the Great Disaster. And like, well, I want to know what that is before I move on. And that's when I kind of fell out. So go ahead. So Mike, can you tell us what the Great Disaster is?
Yes, I can. So there is a transport vessel that is carrying many hundreds of pioneers who are traveling from the core of the galaxy to the outer rim as settlers through hyperspace. And it encounters an anomaly in hyperspace, the ship does, and tries to avoid it and ends up, I think, striking it and breaking apart into hundreds of pieces that then are lost in hyperspace and scatter throughout the outer rim of the galaxy and emerging at different points along hyperspace routes. And when they emerge, they're still traveling very fast, and they can crash into celestial bodies or space stations or planets and moons and stuff like that. And when they do, they obviously cause like cataclysmic disasters. And there's one major system that gets hit very badly that a bunch of the Jedi show up to help. And that's the story that Sarah was talking about in the first 100 pages. And then there's another system that the Jedi are not able to get to as quickly that suffers a much greater loss. And that ends up being what they call the Great Disaster. And it kind of reverberates, because it doesn't even end right then. It reverberates throughout that first novel, The Light of the Jedi. And the Jedi try to figure out what caused it and how to prevent it from happening further or again. That's pretty much the Great Disaster.
If I could add, so the ship's called the Legacy Run. So when people call, it's the Legacy Run Disaster, which even gets mentioned in the Justina Ireland book. And so that's what it set up in, as Michael mentioned, these emergences. But the previous understanding for the Republic was that hyperspace was a safe place to travel, that there shouldn't be these things that just pop up in, you know, providing more traffic. And the Legacy Run actually doesn't run into this anomaly in hyperspace, but trying to avoid it is what causes it then to just break apart.
Right.
Yeah, the ship can't handle the stress.
What was this anomaly?
Well, that's the mystery
revealed,
of the first book.
That's revealed much later in the book, and I think it would be a spoiler too.
Right. Yes.
And actually, that's one of the good things that Charles Soule does with this, is that there are various details that come out. He could have just penned them earlier on, but the way that it's sort of, you know, the whodunit, the murder mystery, a lot of it is the ultimate unraveling of various details and facts throughout the book, which is nicely done.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, okay. I'm intrigued. I may read more pages tonight.
Wow.
All right. So now, how does this fit into Star Wars? So, Drew, do you want to take this on?
Yeah. So it's interesting the way it fits into Star Wars, because obviously we get Jedi. We get some Jedi who, and I know there's going to be another questions. We get some Jedi that are familiar to us in the prequel era. We get Operand Sissus and Yarel Poof, who both appear in The Phantom Menace, as well as even just a call out to Yoda. And we knew Yoda lived for hundreds of years, but it's really awesome to see Yarel Poof and Operand Sissus. Aside from them, of course, we have lightsabers. The Jedi have various powers. We get to see that the Jedi have their own special craft, these vector vessels that they're flying around in, and some various other really cool Jedi tricks. So in those ways, we have that, as well as Coruscant being the capital of everything. But it really has a really different feel to it. I mean, for me, one of the biggest differences is how different people perceive the Chancellor. Like, whereas in the prequel trilogy, people are very cynical about politics and everything. But here, it seems to be a brighter outlook. This Chancellor So character, and she has a great vision for the expansion of the Republic. And people are excited. We are all the Republic is this mantra, this motto that gets shared from person to person, and people believe in it. And so it's actually really, it's a much less cynical time than we see in the prequel era. And so it's in a way refreshing.
Mm. Yeah. And this is 200 years prior to that prequel era.
So Mike, if you took out the words Jedi and Force from this book, would it feel Star Wars to you?
That's a great question. I think that it would, because you have so many of the other elements that we recognize as being specifically Star Wars, like hyperspace, you know, this interplanetary travel. Obviously, there's the weapons that we associate with Star Wars, kind of like ships that echo, you know, if you're rewinding time again, ships that echo ships that we're familiar with, but further back. But what makes it Star Wars? I guess the locations are familiar. You know, we see the planet Coruscant. Obviously, that's very familiar from the prequel trilogy. And they name drop other planets that we're familiar with. So, yes, I think that it would be recognizably Star Wars, even if the Jedi didn't show up.
And they even name drop Santeca.
Yes.
Lore Santeca from Force Awakens.
Well, not Lore Santeca, but the
family.
Previous Santecas. So I thought that was kind of a cool call out.
Because Lore Santeca, especially in the Poe Dameron comic book that preceded The Force Awakens, we see him kind of wandering and exploring. And here they're established as explorers of themselves. And so it's a nice retcon for Lore Santeca to have that family background as an explorer family.
Definitely.
For me, that helps when you throw in a name that we all recognize. Yes. And I started reading books, Star Wars books, that you don't know any of the names, and I just can't continue because I got no frame of reference. So the fact that they mentioned that the Santecas.
Yeah, and they're on Naboo, which is another nice name drop there. So
there you go. All right, Sarah, did this feel like Star Wars to you?
Definitely. And I think it expanded how the Jedi use the Force. I think it did a very good job in that, and how they see the Force. And I even cried at some of these passages that I thought were just like the use of the Force was so, like the use of the Force together was very profound. I thought it was done very well. Mm. Like in the Hetzel system, when the Jedi have to take control, and I was amazed.
Now we're looking at a picture right here of the High Republic, and there's like 10 Jedi. Can you name each one of them, or did more stick out?
No.
All right, so then let me ask you, what Jedi, what characters, not just Jedi, but what characters really stuck out to you, Sarah?
To me, it would have to be Avar Chris, who is the Jedi Master, and she also has this ability to, what is that called? She like uses the Force to help other Jedi talk to each other through the Force.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
it's almost like a vector herself of communications.
Yes, yeah. So she's like helps people communicate through the Force, exactly. And then Buri Yaga, I say, would stand out. He's the Wookiee Jedi
with the dreadlocks.
Yeah. There you go. Those would stand out for me. Do you guys have any standouts?
I like the older Jedi character who had almost kind of retired and became a chef for this one outpost of Jedi that were working on, I forget the name of the planet that they were on.
Elfrona.
But he's basically like turned inward. He turned to like peace and then like assisting, you know, mentoring these other Jedi. But then when it came down to it and he had to like step back into action, he was able to do that at like a moment's notice. And he almost like one of the other characters observing him said he almost like became a different person when he became the warrior again, rather than just this person that he had known as their like personal chef, basically. I don't remember the character's name. I'm sorry.
We'll call that one Gormanda.
Okay, looking it up. Porter. That's his name.
It's funny because the character is also like the Padawan who was on that planet for me was the one that stuck out. But just like Michael, I don't remember the name.
Okay, yeah. The Padawan's name is Bell.
Right.
But it was really cool. But for me, it was really cool finding out that the Jedi have these outposts, especially sort of on like frontier outposts. They're sort of just out there, which is a really fascinating phenomenon.
At this press conference we had gone to in February, they showed us pictures of these Nile characters.
Yes.
And they looked like the Knights of Ren.
Oh. Yeah.
So yeah. I'm really interested to know how these characters stand up in this book.
Oh.
Are they as threatening as they look? Are they like Knights of Ren where you don't see them for majority of the story?
They're there. I mean, they are definitely part of the story, especially their leader who is a really fascinating character himself. So that, yeah, I think, and the way that they, some of their tech and some of their tactics, I think are the most menacing.
I will say I was hesitant in the same way I was hesitant about the Jedi. I was hesitant about the Nile when we first learned about them, because to me, it just seemed like, okay, they're pirates or marauders or something, but they do start out that way. And what makes them unique at the beginning is they have some tech that sets them apart from other marauders in the Outer Rim or whatever. But that's kind of spoilerish that I wouldn't get into. And what made them more interesting for me as the story went on is that the leadership evolves as we get later in the book. And we start to figure out what the machinations are going to be about how the hierarchy pans out in the Nile, and that became very interesting, and how they're going to use the Jedi against themselves.
Oh,
yeah.
So are they as vicious or as threatening as other Star Wars villains we've seen, or are they in denial? I'm sorry, I had to go there. But the question remains, are they as threatening as like the Sith or the aforementioned Knights of Ren?
Well, they don't have the Force, which is what sets them apart from those villains. But they do have this other very unique thing that I don't even want to say what it is.
No, don't say it.
But it does give them an interesting
edge
against the Jedi. And like Drew was saying, different strategies that they can use that we haven't thought of before in these type of space battles.
Right. Yeah. And I do like the fact that this book does, like you said, it establishes the Nile and then something shifts within the Nile that makes them even more dangerous moving forward. So that's exciting.
Boy, I can't wait until this is a movie.
I know, right?
Well, you're going to get a Disney Plus show, at least, in the High Republic.
So. Oh, that's right.
Very much so. Called?
The Acolyte.
The Acolyte, yeah.
Nice.
I'll have to wait until then.
All right. Did you guys have any passages that stuck out? I happen to have one more, but I wanted to refer to you guys.
Well, I love what Drew was saying about how our perspective changes on how the Republic is at peace, and there's more of a general consensus about the direction that the galaxy is going in. So I flipped to this one it's reacting to the Jedi having helped that one system that was in the most danger from the emergences. But I'll just read this paragraph real quick. Across the galaxy, cheers of relief and joy. Yes, scowls from those who lived in darkness, hoping for the Jedi to fail, to be crushed, to die, but they were few. This was a republic that valued and celebrated life and those who preserved it. This was a victory.
Hmm. Well, nice.
That's powerful.
Yeah. All right. Well, I have a passage, and this speaks to the girl in me. Avar, Chris, who is our Jedi, our musical Jedi, Avar sank to the ground, settling herself, legs crossed. Her shoulder-length yellow hair, seemingly on its own, moved back and away from her face. It folded itself into a complex knot, a mandala, the creation of which was itself an aid to focus. She closed her eyes. Jedi can do their hair with the Force! I'm excited! I want to do that! I want to braid my hair with the Force! How awesome is that? And it helps her focus. Like, that's so cool! That just tickled me. I loved it.
Can they do their nails, too? How are they on
I don't know.
Manny's and petties? Yeah.
They probably just do that together in their rooms. It's more fun that way.
During their slumber parties?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Where they bake cookies with the Force. I don't know.
That's a whole new Disney Plus series right there.
Yes.
All right. So that was the first novel.
Light of the Jedi.
And then Claudia Gray had written the YA novel, Into the Dark.
Yes.
So let's touch in on this. So can you give us an overview on this book, Sarah?
Sure. So this follows Padawan Reeth Silas. He's being sent from the galactic capital Coruscant to the undeveloped frontier, specifically the Starlight Beacon, which is that space station in the Outer Rim. And he is not very happy about it because he'd rather stay at the Jedi Temple studying the archives. He loves the archives. He would be a Jocasta Drew. So, but the ship that he's traveling on to the frontier, it's knocked out of hyperspace in the great disaster, and Reeth and his fellow Jedi and other travelers, they find refuge on an abandoned space station. But then strange things start happening on this station, mysterious dark side visions, and the Jedi investigate the station, and an ancient mystery is revealed that could harm the Republic on a huge scale.
Is it haunted? Is this like a Halloween book?
Kind of. Kind of is haunted, wouldn't you guys say?
Oh. Yeah,
in a way.
Drew Kaplan, what's your reaction on this book?
So having just finished it this morning, it's super fresh in my mind. First of all, as Michael mentioned earlier, Claudia Gray has written great books. Lost Stars, Leia, Princess of Alderaan, Master and Apprentice, and of course, Bloodlines. She turns in another good one. What is hugely different from this book then Light of the Jedi is that we actually get a feel for who these characters are, that we really know who they are, what motivates them, aside from Geode, which is a whole other thing. But we really have a good sense of who they are, what their motivations are, and especially sort of, like, it's hard to think who even is the main protagonist. Like, we have a handful of key protagonists, and yet nobody suffers in their character development for it. We all have intimate understandings of who they are. For me, also, what's really cool is Claudia Gray really has a great sense of Star Wars. She has a really good feel for the aesthetic, and she's also able to throw in really key, really cool insights into various aspects of Star Wars, whether it's driving in hyperspace, whether it's Padawan braids or other things. She really has a good sense of the universe. So, as usual, it's another solid read from Claudia Gray.
All right, Mike Celestino.
This was my favorite of the three novels that we read of the High Republic so far, for the reasons that Drew already mentioned. And then also going back to what Sarah was talking about earlier, with one of the minor problems with Light of the Jedi is that there were so many characters introduced that you never really got to connect with anyone. This is more centrally focused on this guy, Reeth Silas, and then there's a few other characters surrounding him as they travel to the space station that you get to know very well also. And for that reason, you know, again, I felt more connected to these characters and was able to follow along with them on their journey and connect with them on their journey throughout this. I don't know. I don't want to say too much, or I don't know how many spoilers we want to get into here, but it's a more personal story for me. So I enjoyed it for that reason.
So does Light of the Jedi and Into the Woods, Into the Dark, do those books cross over events, or are they continuous? Are they sequels?
Sort of. So about an eighth of the way through Into the Dark is when the Legacy Run event happens, and it affects the events that take place in this book. but we don't really see much of what's going on. Although I will say, I was shocked to find that Reeth Sylas is mentioned in the Jedi book, The Light of the Jedi. Right. Yeah. He's mentioned as a 17-year-old Padawan who has talent, and he's going on this journey with these two other Jedi. So it's that there's one paragraph in Light of the Jedi that does mention these characters, but really it's almost as if it's a totally different experience that just happens to be taking place contemporaneously with The Light of the Jedi.
Right.
So I know you love musicals. So what is your reaction to Into the Woods? And then tell us about Into the Dark.
Okay. Well, Into the Dark. Similarly, I did like the fact how they were able to focus on several characters. And being at the Project Luminous press conference when they announced this, Claudia Gray mentioned that one of the characters in her novel was basically based on Matthew McConaughey. And yes, it was Matthew McConaughey on the page was like the pilot of this ship. So I could totally just visualize him the whole time, which I thought was fun. And I did like the fact that much like the Salamari of the Thrawn trilogy, which are creatures that get rid of the Force, like you can't feel, they create Force bubbles. Claudia Gray invents a character that is a different way of harnessing the dark side of the Force. So I'm not going to say more than that, but it was a very inventive way of using the Force. And so I did appreciate that. I felt that the story, for me, because the character names were like kind of weird, it took me a while to understand who they were talking about. And then the story did leap around sometimes in time, 25 years, like going back to a previous experience and then coming back to the present. So that for me, for some reason, I had trouble like getting into this novel, but by the end, I was definitely invested. And by the end, this book hit me subconsciously because I had like this epic dream right after I finished.
If this is another one of your Matthew McConaughey dreams, I don't want to hear about it.
But in this dream, I was like this dark creature chasing Rey over rooftops of houses and using the Force. And like, it was like this really weird in-depth dream that, yeah, it was like born of this novel in a weird way.
Okay. You know what? I'm good with that.
Yeah. So there you go.
Are there any characters or names that pop out? Some people may call it fan service. I call it a fun callback or call forward. Mike?
There is one specific thing in this novel. When I came across it, I ran and opened up a comic book. And I was like, this is the thing that I recognized from this novel. It's a recent comic book. I'm not going to spoil what it is, but if you've been paying very close attention to Star Wars canon in the last few years, you're going to get a payoff, but in reverse for something that has popped up now in the High Republic that has previously appeared in a Marvel Star Wars comic book. And I won't say what it is.
All right.
For us, can you say what it is?
Yeah, we'll edit this part out.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Wow, that is awesome. All right, there's a certain comic line I'll have to go and revisit.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Yeah.
People are going to make a big deal about that, and I'm very proud to have been the first person or one of the first people to notice it because, you know, we got early copies of this, obviously, but I think it's going to be much ballyhoo is going to be made about that connection.
Hmm. Wow.
That's really cool.
Wow.
I mean, aside from that, there is like one Yoda mention, but not as many callbacks.
Yeah.
Is he baby Yoda?
No, like literally they just like mention Master Yoda who's off, you know, but it's right. Like,
well, this is 200 years. So he wouldn't be a baby Yoda. He'd be like 700 at this point.
Right. He's still significant on the Jedi Council. I will also say other callbacks. This is not exactly a character, but Claudia Gray makes reference to like Gadolinium, this or that. It's like a planet that she keeps mentioning it from Bloodlines to Leia, Princess of Alderaan. Like there, and I think there's a drink, Port in a Storm, which she mentions. She also mentioned like Bloodlines. So there's some things that are Claudia Gray things that are,
yes,
that's really cool.
And I believe she also mentioned Tonnerrey, which is Alderaanian wine.
Yes, which is also significant in Bloodlines.
Yeah. Yes.
So that's her version of 1138.
Yes.
Basically, yes. Also, I have to bring up this passage that was really funny. The vessel bucked under them like a blurg having a bad day.
We've all been there.
I loved that line.
That's the line where we were driving and you made us pull over so you can show me this line.
Yep.
Well, justifiable. Yeah. So Drew, any passages stuck out to you in this book?
Absolutely. So I actually have several of them. One was about this notion of a Jedi Wayseeker, which is really phenomenal, which is a Jedi who would operate independently of the dictates of the Jedi Council. Some Jedi, from time to time, found themselves drawn to a period of solitary action, whether that meant meditation on a mountaintop, helping revolutionaries on a tyrant-ruled world, or even, in one legendary instance, becoming a minor singing sensation on Alderaan. All paths could lead to a deeper understanding of the Force, Reith had heard. So that was really interesting to hear about these sort of more independently minded Jedi who really wanted to just go off, do their thing. You can call it independently researching, but they were really more solitarily oriented. And then one final one, which has to do with how would you define Jedi? And so this occurs in a book, in a place in a book where a Padawan is talking to a girl who's never met the Jedi, has no idea what they are. And so he offers two different lines of what they are. So the Jedi are Force users united in our quest to understand the mysteries of the Force and to serve as guardians of peace and justice throughout the galaxy. We ground ourselves in a spiritual existence and give up individual attachments in order to focus entirely on greater concerns. So for me, that was really fascinating to hear that articulation of what it is to be a Jedi.
Nice.
Boy, you did your homework.
Yeah.
I had one line that really stuck out for me in this book. I wish I had highlighted or dog-eared it or something, but I can't find it again. But if you read it after listening to this, I'm sure you'll notice it. And I think it's a meta commentary on the way we treat and view Star Wars canon and continuity, because they're talking about in-universe legends and whether legends can be believed. And one of the characters said something like, there's no reason to discount legends entirely. And I was like, that's Claudia Gray's like meta commentary on the legends continuity in Star Wars. It's gotta be. And I kind of regret, actually, because I did interview all the authors. I regret not asking her about that. But if I ever get to talk to her again, I will do that.
Wow. That's awesome.
That's right out there.
I'm pretty sure that was the intent with that line, but
yes, it is. I'm sure. that's too on the nose.
Yeah, exactly. No kidding. Wow. Oh my gosh.
All right, so let's move on to this final book, the middle grade book, A Test of Courage by Justina Ireland. All right, so Sarah, give us the rundown of this book.
All right, so Vernestra Rowe has just become a Jedi Knight at only 15, but her first real assignment feels an awful lot like babysitting. She's been charged with supervising 11-year-old aspiring inventor Avon Staros on a cruiser headed to the dedication of the new space station, Starlight Beacon. Does this sound familiar? But soon into their journey, bombs go off aboard the cruiser. While the adult Jedi try to save the ship, Vernestra, Avon's droid J6, a Jedi Padawan, and an ambassador's son make it to an escape shuttle, but communications are out and supplies are low. So they decide to land on a nearby moon, which offers shelter, but not much more. And unbeknownst to them, danger lurks in the forest.
Wow. So it sounds like this starts right where Light of the Jedi ends.
So it starts off after the Legacy Run incident, and then it ends basically before the end of Light of the Jedi. So it actually is 100% taking place contemporaneously with Light of the Jedi. It's just sort of within it and totally separately. And I mean, I actually find it really fascinating because it's a lot more intimate as far as the characters go. But also it's a smaller model of showing this brewing conflict between the Republic and the Nihil.
Mike, what is your reaction to this book?
This one is definitely intended for younger readers. It's called a middle grade book, which I think means ages like 8 to 12 or something. And you can definitely tell. I don't think that's a negative necessarily. I would recommend it for that age group if they want to get into the High Republic. This is a good place to start. But also for that reason, it doesn't appeal to me quite as much as the adult book or the young adult book. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, all the characters in this book, all the main characters are younger as well. Again, to have the younger readers kind of identify with those characters. It's also a very, very quick read. I think I got through this in a few hours. It's just, you can inhale this book and there's not a tremendous amount to it. I think also, like, once it first got, it felt like it was getting started just when it ended to me. Like, the book, there's not much that happens really. They crash on this moon and there's a couple things that happen and then it ends. Like, there's just not a whole lot to it. I did think it was fine for what it's supposed to be, but probably my least favorite of the three that we read.
Can I just say 100% to everything Michael said?
Sure. Yeah. Richard, maybe this would be a good read for you too.
Oh, no. I'm over here at the Great Jedi Rescue. This is more my speed. I think a few of these pages have pop-up pictures.
Well, it does have the same advantage that the Claudia Gray book has, which is that we get to focus on just a handful of characters instead of a whole bunch of characters. So you do get to know these few characters that you see on the cover here. There's a couple Jedi Padawans. Actually, this girl has just like kind of graduated to being a full-fledged Jedi, and she's one of the younger people to have become a Jedi in a long time. So that's what's unique about her. And then there's this little girl here. Her last name is Staros, actually. So that's right. Another connection to the current era of Star Wars canon with Sana Staros. And so she's kind of in that family. And then this kid is another son of like a diplomat, I think. And then there's the like fussy droid that you have to throw in, and they get stranded on this planet, and there's really not much more to it. I think it's a moon actually, but there's not a whole lot more to it than that. There are some villains from the Nihil thrown in as well, but I think again, a good entry point for the younger crowd.
Yep.
Nice. Yep,
absolutely. So here are two quick quotes, and what I enjoyed about them, because they're both about this Starlight Beacon, which I think is important for going forward, understanding what this is. And all these books, is I still love that phrasing that Michael put. It's like a pilot. So this is really all setting up whatever's happening whenever this Starlight Beacon opens. So one of these passages is from earlier in the book, which is Starlight Beacon was going to change everything. The Republic space station in the wilds of the Outer Rim would serve as a safe haven in the wilderness, a light in the darkness. It would make the galaxy better for everyone. And then later on in the book, we get this articulation. The space station would increase communication, provide a waypoint for weary travelers, and help the Jedi carry out their missions of peace. Everything about it had been chosen with the majesty of the Republic and the light of the Jedi in mind. Which is a nice callback to Light of the Jedi, because that's also, it's same time, same place.
Yeah. This whole High Republic is giving me this feel of like when, what is it? The U.S. was first populated on the East Coast, and then like the trains were built, and all of a sudden, you know, you could build these places way on the West Coast, and like, you know, it just feels like that. You know, this
the forming
time
of the galaxy,
right. This Western, you know,
civilizations
time.
in these cultures,
right.
Yeah,
it's very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, there we have what's setting up is, it sounds like it's great for everybody, for the Republic, and also what Chancellor So kept on mentioning, we are all the Republic and people want to be part of this project. And yet there's pushback, because it feels almost, yes, it's pushing out to the frontier, but also a little bit colonialist of an Enterprise having the space station way out there, which is, it's great for the Republic, but not everybody out there is part of the Republic. Obviously it's bad for these Nihil, right? They're going to be pushing back. And so, but who knows who else could also not stand to benefit. And it may sound great for people in the core, right, in Coruscant, but maybe not so great for everybody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because there's already established colonies, like you said, or established civilizations already out in the Outer Rim and things.
All right, so now, when do these books come out?
So, Light of the Jedi, A Test of Courage, and The Great Jedi Rescue come out January 5th.
Yeah.
And then the first issue of Marvel The High Republic comic releases on January 6th. So you have one day to read all those books and then read the comic.
I'm in trouble.
And then February 2nd is the release of Into the Dark. And then the IDW High Republic Adventures comic series comes out on February 21st. So it's kind of a 2-month long rollout for these first big stories.
All right, so now this following info was released the day after we recorded with Mike and Drew, so we wanted to insert it here.
Yes, because we also got word at the live stream about even more books coming in the summer, and there's 4 more novels that are coming, and you can view the rundown on skywalkingthroughneverland.com, but we also got more of an idea of the scope of this project. So, StarWars.com will join the High Republic initiative with a brand new bi-monthly show that will be on the Star Wars YouTube channel, and it'll be hosted by Christina Ariel, and it will take fans behind the scenes with creators, artists, and authors, and it's called Star Wars The High Republic Show.
Of course.
Well, yeah, you gotta be able to search for that, right? And also, along with all these books, Star Wars Insider Magazine will be publishing Starlight Stories in most of their monthly issues moving forward. And this is a series of tales that's written by Justina Ireland and Cavan Scott.
Starlight Stories. Oh, because it's from the Starlight Beacon?
Yes, oh, okay. I believe so.
Look
yeah.
at that. Oh, yeah. So tightly woven.
I find this interesting because, like, Star Wars Insider Magazine is usually a magazine of, like, news, right? But it's having some stories here from High Republic. And then also this was exciting news. We got more of the scope of this entire project because Lucasfilm Publishing creative director Michael Siglain revealed that right now we are in the first phase of this multi-year project rollout. And currently phase 1, we are in it right now. It will be all this year and part of 2022. And this phase is called Light of the Jedi. Phase 2 is called Quest of the Jedi. And phase 3, Trials of the Jedi.
This harkens to Marvel.
Oh, yes. Yes, it does.
It's about time.
Yes, I know. So, and what's interesting about this, it's multi-year. And then, Disney Plus announced a new series.
Star Wars Acolyte. All right, now back to our discussion with Mike and Drew.
Ooh.
And if these books do really well, then Star Wars The Acolyte series will stick.
On Disney Plus.
Yeah. And I see here that this show will focus on the emergence of dark side powers in the final days of the High Republic era. So they already have an end cap to this.
Yeah, I want to say actually maybe all the books are building up to that series as like a finale to the whole thing. I don't know.
I bet it is. I bet, and that sounds really interesting. And the Acolyte is someone who follows, right?
Like a Padawan, sure. Like an apprentice.
Yeah. Right, but like a dark side apprentice, I'm sure. Mm-hmm.
So let's put a cap on this, unless anyone has got any other notes on the High Republic books, comics.
I'm excited to read more. I think this is a good start.
Right. Yeah, same. And I really hope we get a novel with Avar Chris as like the main character. I want that so bad.
And maybe there's a beauty salon in the Jedi Temple at some point.
Well, I don't know if we will, because she's already a Jedi Master. I don't know if there's like a story character arc for her, because it seemed like she was very established in that first novel. But I can always hope. A girl can dream.
All right. So as we wrap things up, let's tell everyone once again where we can find our guests here. So Mike Celestino, where can the Skywalkers find you?
Laughingplace.com. I'm contributing stuff there constantly, including a lot of Star Wars stuff. I review every issue of the Marvel Star Wars comics that come out. I review every novel that comes out, every episode of any TV series. So definitely check that out. And then Who's the Bossk is my podcast. And you can find me on Twitter at Who's the Bossk Pod. That's B-O-S-S-K. And then, just check iTunes and Spotify for Who's the Bossk if you want to listen to the show.
Highly recommended. All right. Drew Kaplan.
Yes. You can find me, Star Wars Maven, on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and also starwarsmaven.info is the website.
Nice.
So this is a good way to end this discussion with the last line of the Great Jedi Rescue.
Ooh.
As the crowd cheered, the Jedi raised their lightsabers, vowing to always protect the light and life wherever it was found, and to be the guardians of peace and justice throughout the galaxy.
Wow.
Spoiler alert.
Shoutouts, Skywalker shoutouts. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shoutout. Who was photoballed? Shoutout. Who was shared a post? Shoutout.
At the beginning of each month, we give a huge shoutout to our Skywalking Force. So let's begin this new year by thanking the Skywalking Force.
Thanks to Courtney Turkell
and Kelly Turkell,
Carol Cantwell,
Jonathan Heil,
William Magalio,
John Liang,
Dave Kerwin,
Patty Hammond,
Chad Pennycuff,
John Zancanaro,
Nancy Steinman,
Michael Corbett,
Scott Hume,
Glenn Stein,
Carl Fox,
Julie Carwana,
Jeff Long,
Garrett Sessions,
Derek Beeb,
Jennifer Cole,
Mike Ward,
Terry Lee,
Bryn McKinnon,
Chica Fent,
Wynn Patterson,
Patrick Pine,
Peter and Norma Heitman,
The Hunt Family,
Mike Sanders,
Scott Carmichael,
Laura Bryce,
Anthony Kakias,
Randall Gobay,
and Christopher Marino.
So thank you once again to the Skywalking Force. And to become part of the Skywalking Force, Sarah, what do they need to do?
Well, they can go to skywalkingforce.com and check out all the different levels available to the Skywalking Force.
And because of you, the Skywalking Network is going to grow even bigger in 2021.
That's right.
Now with that, Sarah, let's announce the first Skywalker of the Month for 2021.
Who will it be?
Patty and Michael Hammond, long-term Skywalkers. Patty and Michael Hammond,
just sing it with me.
Long-term Skywalkers. Patty is a fangirl, and she writes for Fangirl Next Door. And Michael is just plain awesome. Patty and Michael Hammond.
Congratulations to the very first husband and wife team of Patty and Michael Hammond. The Hunt family became Skywalker of the Week.
Oh.
Yeah, but for the Skywalker of the Month, this is the first time it's been more than one person.
Indeed. Ooh, that's exciting.
2021 is looking up already. So to become a Skywalker of the Month, all you gotta do is react to one of our posts, something on Instagram.
Maybe share our show with people.
Join the pop culture trivia.
Oh yeah, that too. Yeah, just really engage with us. That's what we're looking for, is engagement. And then you too may get your very own jingle by Rob Dellinger for the Skywalker of the Month.
Rob Dellinger, why does that name ring a bell? Oh yeah, he's the John Williams of podcasting. That wraps up this first episode of 2021 of Skywalking Through Neverland. We want to thank Mike Celestino and Drew Kaplan for coming on and sharing their highs and lows of 2020 and their reactions to the High Republic.
We also want to thank all of you Skywalkers for listening, watching any live streams that we do, and thank you for commenting on our posts of the show. That really gives us fuel for the fire. We love it.
And thanks for everyone for joining us on Pop Culture Trivia on January the 1st. What a way to ring in the new year.
That was super fun.
Now, Pop Culture Trivia is back every Friday at 6:30 p.m. and
Pacific time,
right? The big winners last week were Courtney Turkell, you, Sarah.
That's right.
Teresa won a round.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Bryn McKinnon, I believe, was up there too. Yeah, it was the lady. It was ladies' night.
All right, guys. We got to triumph this coming week.
I don't know.
We've got a lot of good categories coming up.
Ooh.
Yeah, especially those who are fans of the Brat Pack.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, this should be super fun trivia this Friday, and it's just a great way to connect over all of this madness that we're having. Everyone's staying in.
And having a good time.
Absolutely.
Now, starting on Friday, January 15th, we're going to have live roundtable discussions on WandaVision.
Ooh.
That'll be on Zoom.
Yes.
And that's going to happen right after Pop Culture Trivia at about 7:45 p.m. Pacific Time. We had done this with Mandalorian Season 2.
Yes.
We had so much fun. So many people came on and gave their viewpoints. Now we'll continue it with WandaVision, Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
I know.
Book of Boba Fett.
And I just want to share that if you can't make it to our Zooms, we will be recording those and just sharing the audio with our Skywalking Force. So as Skywalking Force members, you'll be able to listen to that later, even if you can't make those Zooms that are open to everyone.
Yeah, and you can let us know in the comments that whether or not you think Mark is right or wrong. You know, it's up to you.
All right, Skywalkers. Well, don't forget, sign up to receive our weekly newsletter where we'll have a rundown of all this information. And you can sign up by clicking on the link in our show notes or heading to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and looking for that tab, sign up for our newsletter.
Now, we also want to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations, for their continued support through all of these lockdowns and shutdowns and everything. They've been right there for us, and we can't thank them enough. So, are you thinking of a trip to a Disney park? You can fill out a get a quote form at smallworldvacations.com today. Their vacation planning service is free of charge, so check it out and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
We are part of the Skywalking Network.
Where
you can also find other great shows like Talking Apes,
classic Marvel Star Wars comics,
the Max Effects podcast,
the Neverland Clubhouse,
and Resilience Squadron, and perhaps another podcast coming in January.
Mm-hmm.
You can find us on social media. We are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok.
I know. I need to get back on TikTok.
You can also join our Facebook group, which we've had a couple new members this week. And I just looked, and there's like over 700 people in our Facebook group. I don't know how that happened.
Wow. And that's even after screening each and every one of them.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, our Facebook group is still one of the most kindest, nicest places of Star Wars and Disney fandom on the internet. We love it. So you can search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join, and then answer the questions that pop up.
Now, don't forget to stick around for bloopers and other fun little bits that didn't make it into the show.
Oh boy.
And
there are a lot of those. And always remember,
Neverland on Alderaan.
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
Also, I want to know how you watched Wonder Woman 1984 on Disney Plus.
You know what? I'm sorry, HBO Max. Sorry. I'm sorry, Disney Plus.
They don't own DC yet.
Well, you know what? I'm looking at the future. They're going to own everything.
Yeah, so. I'm sure they will at some point.
What could you do better next time?
Right. All right.
So, Drew, should we revisit you again and ask you?
I have it.
What didn't meet your expectations? Artemis Fowl. What? Onward. Huh?
No, I said my piece.
Okay. All right. Artemis Fowl. Okay. Well, that wraps up.
Our heads are like so not in the game.
Well, that wraps up episode.
Our first episode. Oh.
Well, that wraps up our very first episode of Skywalking
Up.
Well, that wraps up our first episode of 221. What is going on?
We're tired. It's been a long day.
Oh, my goodness. Well, that wraps up.
There's a reason we record before 4 p.m.
Yeah.